Got it.
Alrighty.
All right. So I'll get rid of me here. Hide self view. There we go. All right. Yeah, it's just too distracting if I'm like looking at myself. I don't know what it is about that. All right. So what we're going to talk about here is post-processing, and that's how you get the good stuff from the pictures that you've taken with your camera or your phone. And so I was trying to think about, well, one of the things that always comes up among photographers is, oh, what's the best camera to use? And it's getting to the point where people say the same sort of things about the software. All right, so what's the best software to use? Well, so the best I could think of to do an analogy was that it's kind of like asking what's the best restaurant, right? They all do the job, and some of them do it better than others, and some of them do it more expensively than others, and sometimes the cost and the results are proportional, and sometimes they aren't. And so, you know, there really isn't any best tool to use. I can show you what I use, and we can talk about it. And what I really wanted to do is talk about basic concepts. So just a little bit about tools, and then we're gonna dive into basic concepts. And these apply regardless of what tool you're using. All right, so I really use mostly two tools, and that's it. One called ACDC, and the other one called Photoshop. And you no doubt heard of Photoshop. I don't know if you've heard of ACDC or not, but ACDC is kind of an easy way to process your photos and also organize your photos. So they call it organizing and developing, but I'm going to show you doing both. And I think you'll see why this is something that's really easy. And then, so that's on my left-hand list. My right-hand list, this is stuff that I paid for, but I never use or very rarely use. And so Adobe Lightroom, Luminar and Neo from Skylum. They're a company in Ukraine, actually. Topaz, they have a whole bunch of different products, something called Photomatics, and something that only runs on phones called Snapseed. So I've got all those things, I've worked with them a little bit, and what I find is I keep coming back to ACDC and Photoshop. If it's simple, I do it in ACDC. If it's more complicated, I want to do composites, or I want to print, then I'll use Photoshop. And the thing about the stuff that I rarely use is there's always some new product that's coming out, and they say, this is the best thing for like getting a style. You know, all these presets are built in there, and all you have to do is make one click on the preset you like, and it does everything for you. And okay. So I look at it and I try it, and I'm like, it's not quite what I want. It's close, but it's not quite what I want. So then I end up going back to my tried and true toolkit and using that. So anyway, if you have questions about any of those, happy to show them to you. I might save you spending the money on them. But I'm actually going to look at, do everything in ACDC here tonight, unless you guys have specific questions. And it's up in the right-hand corner of the screen. It's probably an eye test, and it probably will continue to be an eye test most of the evening here. But we'll make do. So any questions about what's the best restaurant?
Restaurant?
So what tools do you guys use when you want to edit a photo? You know, you make it brighter, make it darker, do something with it. What tools do you guys use?
Go ahead, Eric.
I use mostly Photoshop. Photoshop is kind of my go-to. I've played around with some of the other, you know, like demo software and stuff, but I always seem to just kind of go back to that. And that's why I'm real curious tonight to see about this ACDC, because I know you've talked about that quite a bit. And I know Gina, she's talked about Topaz. She writes mm-hmm. about that. And I guess they've got some new software out called AI, and it kind of like is the everything. And it just came out this week, I guess. But Photoshop is really my go-to one, so.
Yeah, you can do everything with Photoshop, but it's got a steep enough learning curve, and it's got every feature known to man and then some. And it can be kind of daunting.
It can be. And I tell people, I said, you know, it seems like every time I turn around, I go down the rabbit hole and I find like 12 new features that I never knew existed. And I could have sworn I was down there before.
Right.
You know? Even the other day I was playing with some photos and I was like, oh, I didn't know I could do that.
And there's always a major keystroke, like it's Alt Control Shift E. And then that does some magical new thing. And you're like, wow, that's pretty cool. And then, you know, a couple of weeks later, you come back and you've completely forgotten it.
Yeah. So.
All right. So let's go on to the next one here. All right. So these are the basics. So exposure, contrast, saturation, sharpness, and geometry. And then from there, you can drop down into a lot more stuff. But if you understand those basic concepts with post-processing, you're in great shape. And one of the reasons I really like AC/DC is what you see there in the illustration is that's the dashboard for AC/DC. And it does all of that stuff right there in that little chunk of screen real estate, which it's all on sliders. So no magical keystrokes, no confusing. You have to set four different things to make it work. It's all right there for you, which I really like. So keep it simple. All right.
So let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
AC/DC, is that expensive?
No. In fact, I think they'll give it to you for free for 30 days.
Uh-huh.
And they have three different versions of it. So small, medium, and large. And I think small maybe like $49, medium is like $79, and I think large is like $150. Huh. So you try it for 30 days and you decide which version of it you want.
Or now, you don't small, want it at all. But a small, fewer tools within or what?
The difference between the different versions, they don't call it small, medium, and large. They got some other name for it, but that's basically what it is. If you look at the large one, it's got all kinds of AI stuff built into it. And if that's something that you're interested in, then, you know, it does great stuff. If you're doing a lot of panoramas, you need to stitch those together, it'll do that for you. If you're doing a lot of HDR work and you need to take different exposure levels and merge those, it'll do that for you. If you're a portrait photographer and you want to make someone's eyes a little bit bigger or maybe their cheekbones a little thinner, things like that, you want to actually change the shape of a face, it'll do that for you. And all three of the different versions will help you organize your pictures. So this is really a two-purpose tool. One is to do development, the basics of development, and the other one is to help you organize your pictures so you can find stuff.
Is that retroactively easy, or does it have to be as you go along?
It is retroactively easy. That's what I really like about it. It's if you've used Lightroom, Adobe's Lightroom, it'll also do a nice job organizing things, but it's not retroactive. You've got to go in and you got to import everything. And I've paid for it for years and I never use it. It comes along with Photoshop. You buy Photoshop, you get Lightroom. And you'd think that because I already have it, I wouldn't pay my annual fee to AC/DC, but I do because it's worth it. Yeah, so let's flip over here to AC/DC. And so one of the things I love about it is this is the AC/DC homepage or the dashboard. And what it does is it just shows me little thumbnails of all my pictures. And now I have a folder called Workspace, and these are pictures that I'm just working on. So, you know, if I was a painter and this is a studio, this would be a bunch of canvases that were stacking up against the wall. And I just keep track of all kinds of stuff in here. And this is stuff that I've processed or fiddled with or just experimented with. And it's just a nice place to keep track of stuff. And then over here on the far right-hand side, which Eric tells me is an eye test. I'm gonna move you guys over here. This is how you organize stuff. And I wonder, let me close that down. Let me try something, see if you can see this better.
What are you doing? Then I have a question. So are these all stored on your medium or your computer or wherever, or is it stored on AC/DC's?
This is all stored on my computer.
Okay.
They will let you store
the software and, okay.
Yeah, they will let you store it in the cloud if you want to. They'll let you store it on external hard drives. You can put it any place you want to. I keep it all on my local computer because I got too damn much stuff.
Okay.
Cool. All right. Let me see whether or not this is going to work. Can you read that screen a little bit? Can you see the categories and stuff?
Well, it's a little better if I lean in.
Albums, yeah. People, Photoshop.
Places. Yeah. Okay. All right. So again, this is my workspace. I've just dramatically reduced it. So I'm gonna change the size of my little thumbnails here, which is, you know, real easy to do. And I can scroll up and down. And so if I want to open one of these guys up and take a look at it, I just double click on it and there it is. So it gives me a viewer. I can zoom in on these guys, zoom out.
That looks like me.
Adam's Jr. Yeah, it does. You were there. You were definitely there.
Yeah, I was surprised how you did that picture with the City Lights Art Gallery. It looked really neat that way.
Yeah, it came out good. Yeah, I was a little. So the green screens are used to they're set up so that you can remove a background or you can add a different background in. And so this is just a technology that is real common in the video business. And so all the sci-fi movies that you see, you know, or the superhero movies that you see, they're all done in front of green screens. And so, yeah, the WWDB TV has that nice green screen. I was a little worried about the shadows, but John says, don't worry about them. They're fine. Yep, they were. Yeah, no problem pulling those out. All right, so this lets me just, you know, flip through picture by picture by picture, or I can come back to all my little thumbnails. So it's the easiest thing I've ever seen to keep your pictures organized. And what I love about it is that it allows you to attach labels to your pictures. All right, so like, for example, this particular picture I've got here, this is one that we used on the call we had last week. And I can see all kinds of information. I can see the camera that I used. I can see the lens that was on that camera. I can see how big the image is. I can see what ISO was using, just, you know, all this detailed information, which is kind of cool. It's all available right there. And then now if I want to edit this in Photoshop, I can just click on Tools, External Editors, and I can just come over here and click on Photoshop, and it'll just pop that up in Photoshop. Oh. I have no idea what'll happen if I do that. Let's see. You guys probably won't be able to see this at home. Oh, there it is. You don't see Photoshop, right?
No.
No, okay. All right, that's a waste of time then. Anyway, trust me, I one click and I go into Photoshop with it. And it's so real easy to edit stuff. And then it's also real easy to like label stuff. And so for example, I have a label here called Places. So if I click on that, let me close up some of these. All right, so here are different places that I've got labeled. So I've got Arizona, California, Europe, Mexico, all kinds of different places. Now, for example, if I click on the little plus next to Europe, it's going to show me a bunch of different countries. And if I click on Germany, it immediately brings me up a bunch of thumbnails on a couple of trips to Germany. And, you know, it's just hit quick. And if I want to see, instead of Germany, I want to see Greece. Okay, there's a bunch of pictures in Greece. And we could go, you guys get the idea. Here's Italy. All right, and I can do the same thing with people. So family pics, I can show you, for example, my daughter is Heather. I can show you one click, and there's a whole bunch of pictures of Heather. So here's a spot, you know where this is, right? Here she is with her mom in Nelson, next to the airplane crash. Oh. So real easy to go find stuff. So none of this has anything to do with processing, with post-processing, but it's just a nice way to keep track of your stuff.
Yeah.
And if you don't have a way to keep track of your stuff and you're looking for something, this works great. You've already got a system that works for you, then you know, gosh, you only know, stay with it. But so it allows me to label. So I have labels for people. I have labels for places and a bunch of other stuff I don't really use very much. And then I can also have ratings. So if I want to see all the pictures I've got that are rated 5, it shows me nothing because there's nothing in that folder, but that's, you get that idea. But what the more interesting part here is the keywords. So you can put all these other keywords in here. Like for example, if I want to see pictures that I've taken of castles, this will go get me some castle pictures. What am I not getting any here? Oh, because I got Heather clicked. I don't have Heather at any castles. So that's the problem. All right, let's go. Here we go. All right, so castles. Oh, and there's only one thing labeled as a castle, so I haven't used that very much. How about cats? I think that's probably better. There we go. So a whole bunch of pictures of cats. So if I say, oh, I kind of like this one. So I was at a photo workshop, and we were walking through this little village. And there were all these cats scurrying around, and this was the instructor, and he's sitting there, and he looks like a plumber with his pants on. The cat's busy looking yeah. at him. It's just one of those pictures you can't resist, you know. You got to take it. Anyway, I know it's cats, and I could show you that it's Greece as well. All right. So anyway, and as you can see, I have a zillion labels out here. I've got one for city lights. Let's turn that one off and city lights. All right. So here's city lights. And so one of the things that's kind of cool about it too is I don't have to do this just for pictures. You can also do it for video. So it doesn't care if it's pictures or video, it does it all. And then, you know, as far as the video, I double click on it and it just plays. So really easy to label stuff, really easy to find it. And when I label stuff, it's not like I have to go in and label each one individually. I can select them all and say, these are all city lights. Just click the little check mark here and that's it. Just labels them all. So usually it's one click and to label everything. All right, I'm gonna sound like the AC/DC salesman before long here, if I don't already. All right, so pains, I want to look at the, where's my image basket? I've lost my image basket. It's dropped off the bottom of the page. There we are. All right. One of the things that's kind of cool, let me go back. I'm going to go back to full screen here so that you can see this. All right. So here's all my thumbnails in my workspace. You can see there's a lot of them. As a matter of fact, you can look down here in the lower left corner. You can't see that, but it says 403 items. So I have 403 pictures sitting in my workspace here of all kinds of different things. All right. So there's this thing called the image basket. And this is what I really wanted to show you. Let me make this a little larger. And along the bottom of the screen, I've got a thing called an image basket. And this lets me gather up pictures regardless of what folder they're in. So they don't have to be in workspace. I don't have to know where they are, how they're labeled. If I just see something that I just want to like pull out and save, so I really quickly access it, this is how I do it. I just put it in this image basket. And so what I want to do is I want to show you this picture right here. This is the one we're going to work on. So I took this, and I think this was at Resorts International. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that's where it was. I was over there just wandering around taking some pictures. And I thought what we'd do is some post-processing on this. So this is where we're actually going to get to contrast and exposure and so on. So this is kind of interesting. It's got some really deep shadows down in here. It's got some really bright highlights that you don't want to lose. It's got lots of tricky detail down in here. And so we're gonna process that. And in order to make it really easier to understand the processing, what I did is I created a version of it, which you can see here, has got a grayscale on it. And so a basic concept when you're looking at pictures like this is only 255 levels of brightness. Right, so zero brightness means there's absolutely no brightness whatsoever. It's jet black. 255 means it's white. It's just pure white. So everything that you've got to work with has to fall in between those values. And you can see here, if you look at this, that there is just a slight difference between 0 and 25. And there is a noticeable difference between 240 and 255. And so
did you bring this up? Because all I see is the workspace.
See his workspace. Maybe it's showing a different window.
Now I see you.
See me. See pink screen.
Yeah, I was just going to ask the same thing too. I was like, where is he?
Is that better?
Well, there yes. We go.
Okay. All right. And so the area that I was talking about over is right over here. Yeah, let me slide this down a little bit here. So I've got this grayscale. Let me undo that. Grayscale, it goes from 0, which is jet black, to 255, which is just pure white. And so those are all the values that you have to work with. So everything needs to sit in there. And so, like, for example, I'm going to go over here to develop. And I'm going to move you guys over. Move you guys down there. All right, so the first thing I'm going to do is talk about exposure, right? So right now, this is actually came out of the camera pretty good, right? The highlights are in pretty good shape up in here. You can actually see a little bit of blue sky, but the shadows down here are a little bit dark. And you know, when in doubt, you want to make sure that you don't blow out the highlights. You want to make sure that you got some detail in the highlights because you can pull an enormous amount out of the shadows. But if your highlights are all white, you're toast. There's nothing you can do about that. So I'm going to look at exposure here. And what I want you to notice is as I increase exposure, so if I go up to about, let's say it's going to be about 0.50. Let's look at about 50. You can see how it's gotten brighter. And what's happened, if you look at over here on the grayscale, I've lost the differentiation between 240 and 255. And so it means that the top end of my light colors, my brightest colors, are blown out. And if I go up a little bit more, I go up to about 100. I get to a, well, let's just type it in here. Let's keep it easy. If I go to 100, I've blown out the difference between 225, 240, and 255. And I've lost detail in here. I've lost detail in here. The sky is starting to go white on me. And the picture is starting to look too bright in the light areas. But actually, you're starting to get some detail down here in the shadows. All right, and so you kind of get the idea here. So ideally, what you'd like to be able to do is preserve all the tones. If I go under exposure, if I get it too dark, you'll see now right about there the difference between about 0.5. The difference between 0 and 25 has disappeared. So that means I really lost a lot of shadow detail. All right, does that make sense as far as understanding exposure and the effect it has on what you actually see on the screen and what you actually print?
Yes.
All right, cool. All right, let's look at contrast then. So now watch what happens on the grayscale. I'm gonna pull the contrast up here. And I get to right about there, which is about 41. And I've lost the detail in the shadows. So you can't see any difference between 0 and 25. And you can barely see 50 difference. And I've also lost between 240 and 255. So what contrast has done is contrast has taken the bright tones and made those things brighter. And it's taken the dark tones and made those darker. So sometimes you want to do that and other times you don't. So you can see as I bring the contrast up, I continually losing the differentiation between the different tones. All right, and if I go the other direction with it, it doesn't have much effect other than to maybe make the difference between 0 and 25 and the difference between 240 and 255 a little more apparent. All right, so you guys totally understand about contrast and exposure then? That's cool with that? All right, so let's talk about, yeah. Let me get back to where we needed to be here. Let's undo that. Okay, so now the next slide I want to look at is saturation. And this is an interesting one because saturation, if you just drag saturation up, and now we're not going to be looking at the grayscale for a bit here, the colors just become more intense. Almost to the point where if I slide it all the way up, it's kind of oppressively intense. Now, one of the things that's kind of a mystery is vibrance. So vibrance seems to do pretty much the same thing, but see, vibrance is a little smarter than saturation because what saturation does is just across the board, just brightens up all, makes the colors more intense. What vibrance does is it only makes the colors that aren't intense more intense, but the ones that are already pretty intense, it doesn't mess with. So I think the explanation on this one would be something about it's where the saturation is a linear increase, vibrance is kind of a logarithmic or a geometric increase. And so if it's already pretty intense, it ain't going to add anything to it. But areas that didn't have much color, it's going to add them. It particularly works well on faces. So vibrance definitely can be your friend. Sometimes you can use them together too. I can bring up a little saturation if I just want overall color and then bring up the vibrance to pop it a little bit. All right, those make sense? Were you guys aware of vibrance? Have you used that before?
I used to use Photoshop, Adobe or something like that. And then I kept up for a while with it. And then all of a sudden I didn't. And I think they took it away from me or something. They, you know, it wasn't, when I got a new computer, I would have had to buy more and I don't even know. Anyway, so they had all these things on it and I liked it.
Yeah, Photoshop has got all these sliders in it. They've got a thing called Camera Raw that almost looks exactly the same as this. Works just the same.
But it wasn't Photoshop. It was
Was it Lightroom?
I don't know what you're saying.
Okay. There's a whole bunch of different products that all do the same kind of thing. And most all of them have the sliders.
That I think it was called Element something. Photoshop.
Yes, Photoshop Elements. Photoshop. Yes. Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, that's kind of a Photoshop light.
Yeah. Is that even available anymore?
Yeah, they still make that. Yes, they do. Yeah. And I want to say that's about, it's about the same price as the middle tier of AC/DC. So $69, $79, something like that. And so if you had that, you would get all these sliders, you'd get all these controls over colors and saturation and contrast and everything. What you don't get is you don't get the organization stuff. So you don't get a way to label all your pictures so you can go and you can retrieve them. All right, so what was next on our list here? Oh, sharpness. Let me look at sharpness. All right, so sharpness is on the detail tab here. And so sharpness is going to, it just takes objects and where there's contrast, where there's a difference between the brights and the darks, and it's going to add a little bit of additional light to that boundary. And so if I slide this over, you'll see up in this little screen here, maybe you can't see it. If I bring it all the way up, you might be able to see it. The overall effect, of course, is that the picture just looks a little bit brighter because what it's done is it's put just a little bit of a white line around all the places where there's contrast, where there's a sharp break in contrast. So this is one where, let me see if I can make this. Let's see if we can make this bigger. Let's go like 300%. There we go. All right, so this makes the point. All right, so with no sharpening, it looks like that. And with maximum sharpening, you can see how it's got this little white edge around everything. And now I don't know whether you guys can see the noise in here. Does it look like it's the surface is sandpaper, or does it just look like it's a kind of a tan color?
Oh, it looks okay.
Okay, all right. So you don't see the noise because of the screen resolution, but you can also reduce noise in here. And typically, this is just a single click, and you just bring this over, and right there, I've pulled out all the noise completely. And so now it really looks smooth rather than granular. All right, so, all right, and then the last basic concept thing is about geometry. And this has saved my butt so many times because I've got this thing where I always want to tilt my camera to the left. And I end up with things that should be straight that just aren't straight. And I think I've got a better picture to illustrate that.
Well, that's nice to hear. I'm not the only one that does that.
I do it all the time, Eric.
I don't know what it is.
I don't know. I just never get it straight. So, all right. So now I'm going to develop. Here's my lighthouse, right? So you did the painting of the lighthouse, and here's my lighthouse picture. I had to take it. And you guys see the lighthouse, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, cool. All right. So the third little tab over here at AC/DC is for straightening stuff out. And you can see how my horizon just kind of dips. And so this is so easy to do. I just come over here to this little slider and I just drag it over here to the left. I always have to drag it to the left for some reason until the horizon looks nice and straight. They give you a nice grid. And so I'm always off about 1 degree. Yeah, that's very typical. And there you go. I'm good to go. And they've also got cropping built in here too. So like, for example, if I want to just, I always shoot everything 16:9 because that's the format of the screen I use. But let's say what I knew that I wanted to do this is an 8:10 enlargement. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to crop it and I'm just going to come over here and select 8:10. And there you go. And if it turns out that I want to move it around, I can. So let's say I want to do a rule of thirds kind of thing and I want to bring the lighthouse over just a little bit on the left side here. Let's go about like that. And there you go. Mm-hmm. And then, all right, so exposure, contrast, saturation, sharpness, and geometry. And then there's a whole bunch more. All right, so let me show you some of the other things that are kind of cool. So one of the things that you may run across, and this is really simple to do, is white balance. So now this looks a little blue to my eye. It's really easy on white balance. You pick something that's gray. And so normally pavement is like the perfect for white balance. So I click on that pavement and I get a nice white balance on that. But let's say rather than a cream colored lighthouse, I want a pure white lighthouse. And so if I click there, I get a much more pure white lighthouse. It's subtle, you guys may not be able to see it. And now this particular one, this looks a little dark to me, but the highlights here don't look too dark, but the people down in here and the lighthouse can be a little brighter. And so one of the things that AC/DC does is it gives you this thing called light equalization. And what this lets me do is selectively make the shadows brighter, and it doesn't affect the midtones or the highlights. Isn't that cool? How easy it is to do that. So here is before, and here's after, with just that one little slider. And then you can take the highlights and I can darken them down a little bit. We make that sky just a little darker. And maybe even just a little bit more in the dark areas. So now it starts to look pretty sweet. If you really want to get crazy, you can. So if I go back here, so that's what it started out like. It's not a bad picture, but that's much nicer. And I haven't done anything with exposure or contrast or saturation. Now, in this case, I don't know that I want it more saturated because I don't think this grass needs to be much greener, but we might give it a little vibrance. So let's do that. And it should, yeah. So it perks up the blues. And so the ocean looks a little bluer and the sky looks a little bluer. And I love what's happening up here in the glass in the top of the lighthouse. It's, you know, it's got that green glass look to it, which is cool. And then the last thing I might do here is just hit it with a little sharpening. Didn't really need it, but just kind of makes the point. All right. And so again, what's kind of cool is I can look at the before and after view. So that's what it looks like. And that's what it started out like. And you know, with about four clicks of the mouse, there we are. And so this is really where I wanted to get to. I want to show you that once you get a tool like this, you can just very quickly go through these pictures. And if it turns out I've got a whole bunch of pictures I took of this lighthouse, you know, different compositions, but the lighting is pretty much the same. Maybe I walked around a little bit, just took a whole mess of additional pictures. I can actually go in and it's got this thing called Apply Last Used. And so it'll take whatever settings I use all the way across the board, in my general settings, my white balance, my shadows, my highlights, my sharpening, all of that stuff. It'll save all that stuff. And then I can just apply it to another picture just with one click, or I can apply it to, you know, 20 pictures with one click, which is really nice, particularly if you've got a whole bunch of stuff you need to work with.
That's a really nice feature.
Isn't that cool? And then you can also set it as a preset. So it'll remember the previous settings, which is great when sometimes you want to go in and subtly change them, and then it's going to remember the previous settings that you subtly changed it to. But you can also save it as a preset, and then it'll go in and it'll just retrieve that. So I've got a whole bunch of presets out here. And yeah, I particularly need presets when I'm working with the drone, because the drone doesn't do much of anything with the pictures. It's just pretty much raw stuff. All right, so that's really the basics. I mean, there's an enormous amount of additional stuff that you can do with this, but that's really the basic stuff. And that's really what I wanted to do is kind of show you guys the basic concepts about post-processing, and then how easy it can be to take something that is compositionally looks pretty good, and you can turn to something that's really quite nice.
Yeah.
There's a there's another one here. I got to show you this one. So I'm still working on the general layer. This is just the regular stuff. There's something called clarity. And watch what happens if I slide the clarity over. Clarity really makes it pop. So here's no clarity, or here's like no clarity. And I come over here, and that may be kind of subtle, but where you'll really notice it is in the sky at the horizon. So here's low clarity. And you come over here, and it just pops.
Yeah, it does.
Clarity is pretty cool. And then it's also got this thing called dehaze. And dehaze, this is great for distant landscapes, but it'll have a really dramatic effect here. What it does is it tends to pull the distant blues out, and it removes the haze. And so. And it's really easy to put way too much dehaze in here, as you'll see. That's like, it gets kind of cartoonish.
Yeah.
That's only halfway up. I mean, you go all the way, and I'm not quite sure what that is, but I don't use a lot of dehaze, a little bit, maybe if I want to give myself a little bit more dramatic skies. Or if I have a distant landscape, then that works pretty good for doing that. All right, so that's the basics.
Well, thank you.
If I come back over here to manage, what else did I want to show you guys? Let's do this. Let's look at this one. All right, so here's a street shot that could use a little work. And I'll show you how quickly you can pull something together here. All right, so in this case, I'm going to go into my light equalization. I'm going to bring up the shadows. About like that, maybe about there. And I'm going to knock the highlights down just a little bit. And I'm going to give this a little bit of clarity. With the clarity, I'm going to bring the shadow up just a little bit more. Cool. And now I'm going to bring up the vibrance. And come over here to detail. And let's look at this guy's face here. And I'm going to sharpen his face. And that's going to brighten him up. So got a little on this. So as you can see, it's a trial and error kind of thing. You slide a little here, you slide a little there. Maybe a little more saturation here. And that's not too bad. So before, right? Interesting, but you know, really dreary. And then after, it really is brightened up.
Mm-hmm.
And now the composition isn't great. So I'm going to come over here and let's say I want to get another 8x10. So I'm just gonna come over here and 8x10, and I'm just gonna slide this over and wait those guys. We don't really need that whole lantana plant, and we're done. So that's it.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm going to show you this one. So you guys are both familiar with Photoshop and done a little bit. So I've had the best time with this particular picture. I've gone around and I've taken pictures of these old churches. And most of these old churches are in Texas because there aren't a lot of old churches that look like this in Nevada. But there's a whole bunch of these old churches. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to have this Jesus Saves sign on the front of it. And so this is a Photoshop ACDC kind of mix sort of thing. And so that's what I started out with. And that's what I ended up with.
Huh. You sure changed it.
isn't that fun?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I did the basics in AC/DC, and that was straightening up the building because it was cockeyed, and and got it all straightened up, got the contrast where I wanted it to be. And then I went into Photoshop and I knocked the sky out. And then Photoshop has these things called LUTs, which are lookup tables, L-U-T. And it lets you attach a particular look to a photo. And in this case, what it is moonlit night. And then I have my little neon Jesus Saves built, and I just pasted it on the front of the building. And that's actually not, that's not the latest one. Here's the, so some of these ones I'll go through again and again and again to like get it right. Now here it is. So this is the one that's hanging in the gallery now. I just brought it over on Friday. And so, you know, a total Photoshop job on this. All right, well, that's pretty much what I had. Very cool. Is there anything that you guys would like to see or?
No, you did well. I'm, you know, I expected to find other people here with questions and everything. I just wanted to take a look and see whether it was something I wanted to come back in and get more involved in. And, you know, I don't know, but I found it interesting. And it's nice to know that AC/DC especially would be what I would opt for if I were to get back into.
To keep track of your stuff, because so this is my workspace right here. But what I do is I keep my pictures from previous years all in one folder. So this year, let me make this a little larger here. It's an eye test right now. Here we go. All right. So what I do is I put a folder together for a given year. So 2022. And then inside of 2022, every time I download pictures through my camera or my phone, I create a new folder. And then, so you can see, like I downloaded on the 24th. The last time I downloaded was the 24th of September. And it was City Lights. And this is actually the backgrounds I used for the video. And then working for the church. And when we were over at WWDB-TV, those are the videos there. Church stuff and so on. Hey, Eric, if you're still listed, you said go get a picture of the Fiesta sign before it's gone.
Mm-hmm.
So here's my Fiesta sign here with the,
well, you know what?
The skyline in the still background. Showing. What's
oh,
that?
There it is. Okay. Yeah, you got it. I drove by there the other day and they were taking it apart.
Man.
What are they doing to Fiesta? Taking it?
They're tearing it down.
The one on Lake Mead Parkway?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the one right up where the 95 crosses Lake Mead Parkway there.
Oh my, what are they going to put in its place? Anything?
They haven't said. But yeah, we drove by there Saturday morning coming home and they were just, a bulldozer was just ripping it down.
Oh my.
I don't think anybody saved it.
Everything you see behind the sign here, you know, where it says, you know, the building, is gone.
That's nice. Yeah, it's all gone.
The hotel there, the was 5 or 6 story hotel, that's still there. They've ripped the facade off it. That's still there. But all this stuff with the tan roof, that's gone. And they haven't touched the parking garage. And I wonder if they're going to leave that.
Hmm.
Or I wonder if that, because of the way they construct those things, wonder if they got to blow it up or something.
Yeah.
But yeah, after we talk, Eric, I got the drone out and I figure, well, I'll fly around the Fiesta sign. It's going to be gone. And sure enough, about a week later, it was gone.
I'm glad I ran down there when I did at night to snap photos.
Did you get a good shot at night?
Yeah. When it was all lit up.
Yeah.
Yeah. That one and what's the two up north too? Texas Station and the other Fiesta up north.
I don't know that I ever saw those.
Yeah.
Anyway, so the point here is that, you know, I've got a folder for the year and then, you know, I've got a folder that I got three of them for 22, 21, and 20. And then I got something called previous years. And then I got these going back since I started doing digital. And I didn't have to go in here and like manually import all these pictures or anything. It just, I had these pictures on, you know, different hard drives, and I've gone through different computers, and some of them are on CDs. And so I've just brought them in. So, you know, and I, when I did this early on, I really didn't have a way to organize this stuff. So like, this is 20 years ago, but I got all these pictures. They're not like labeled with a nice date on them and everything like I'm currently doing, but you know, all this stuff is still here.
Very nice. Well, I appreciate seeing you and Eric too, and seeing what's going on. And I'm going to get back to my book.
It was all right. Well, thank you so much for joining us. And we're gonna do a workshop Thursday in the gallery, and we'll see how that goes. And if it turns out that that's something people want to do, we'll do more of them. And if it's something that's less interest, then we'll deal with that when we get to it.
Very good. Well, thank you. I'm going to leave.
Okay. Thanks,
bye.
Drina.
Cool.
Bye.
All right. Good seeing you, Drina. Take care.
You, Eric, too. Bye.
Thanks.
So, Eric, thanks for setting this up.
Hey, no problem at all. I'll let me just flip on.
Yeah, I think you're still recording there.
Oh, hold on. Okay, let's stop that. Okay.
So our emphasis on Thursday is going to be a little different. I'm hoping that people bring their own pictures.